Is here, madam.
Oh. Show him in, will you?
Yes, madam.
Good evening, Inspector.
Good evening, Mrs. Paradine. I don't think you've met Sergeant Leggett.
How do you do?
How do you do?
I must say I'm rather surprised to see you again, Inspector. I can't imagine there can be anything else that you want from me.
I know, Mrs. Paradine. I'm aware of what you've been through, but I've been sent here to arrest you.
It's incredible. I'm sorry. Then you want me to go with you?
Yes.
I'll tell them I won't need dinner. Will you ring? The bell is over there, beside the picture. Do you like the picture? It was finished a week or two before he died. I think the artist has caught the blind man's look quite wonderfully.
Mrs. Paradine, I have to use some formal words at this point.
Oh, Laken, ask Helen to give you my black lamb coat and my black handbag. I suppose that if I need other clothes, they can be brought to me.
Yes, ma'am.
Well?
I have a warrant for your arrest. And it is my duty to warn you that you need not say anything, but that what you say will be taken down and may be used in evidence upon your trial. The warrant charges you for that on the 6th of May, 1946, you did willfully administer or cause to be administered some poisonous substance to one Richard Patrick Irving Paradine and did murder him.
Lake and I shall probably not be back this evening.
Very well, madam.
Tell Cook I'm sorry about the dinner.
Yes, madam.
Good night.
Good night, madam.
The trouble is, it's so difficult to get there. We can't go by car, of course.
In here, sir.
I hope you'll forgive my being late. The fact is, I was just dressing for dinner when your call came. I took it in a bath towel.
This is Chief Inspector Ambrose, Sir Simon, my family's solicitor.
Oh, yes, we're old friends. How are you, Inspector?
Well, thank you, Sir Simon. We don't often see you here, sir.
No, you must excuse an old man's foibles. The fact is, I'm not very keen on this place. We'll get out of it as soon as possible, Mrs. Paradine, won't we? As soon as possible.
When you're ready, Sir Simon, we'll make the formal charge. Do you want to go into another room?
No, it's not necessary. Just give me a couple of minutes here. Now, my dear, let's not waste words. You don't have to tell me the police are making a terrible mistake. We mustn't despair. Above all things, we mustn't despair. You're not despairing, are you?
No, Sir Simon.
Now, let me see. They'll read the charge over to you and then ask you whether you've anything to say. I think you'd better say no, just like that, quite simply, no. Is that understood?
Yes.
All right, then.
Maddalena Paradine, the charge is that you, on the 6th of May, 1946, did willfully murder Richard Patrick Irvin Paradine. Do you wish to say anything in answer to the charge?
I have nothing to say.
That's all we can do at present. I'll look in and tell your maid to put together some of your things. You're allowed a few things at this stage.
Who's to defend me? You?
At the trial? Oh, dear me, no, of course not. I'll get you one of the distinguished leaders of the bar. Do you know Mr. Anthony Keane?
I've heard of him, of course.
He's very good in this sort of thing. Full of charm and cunning. But the juries like him, so do I.
Won't it be difficult to get him?
We'll see, we'll see. At the moment, he's on a case in Lincoln. I'll get my daughter to run me down and have a talk with him. You'll like him.
That's not as important as his liking me, is it?
I think he will. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Would you come this way, please?
I will, Simi. I will.
Evening, Baker.
Good evening, sir.
Tony?
Yes, my love.
I knew it. I knew you didn't have an umbrella or raincoat. Oh, darling. Oh. You're wet through, Tony. Baker, will you please bring up the cocktails from the study?
You might ask me if I won my case.
You always win your case. Even though you don't have enough sense to come home dry.
Simi's car. It leaks.
Come and take your things off, darling, and have a hot shower. I'll make you drink strong. And with luck, we may pull you through.
Simi wants me to take a case for him.
Oh?
Mrs. Paradine.
I don't believe she did it.
Well, do you mind telling me why? As a defending counsel, I might be able to use any bit of evidence.
Well, nice people don't go about murdering other nice people.
So you think she's nice?
Her photograph looks nice. And anyone who wasn't nice wouldn't have married that poor blind man. Here you are.
Mmm. Just right.
Good.
So it's your opinion that nice people never murder their husband?
Well, I suppose there are circumstances.
It's amazing how 11 years of wedlock with the greatest realist in the country haven't altered a single one of your lovely delusions about nice people.
I'm glad you're defending her.
Why?
Well, it's... Oh, darling, your hair's too wet. Let me rub it.
Oh, not so hard.
It's nice to be married to someone who can help others, even save their lives.
Don't you?
Mm. But you have changed, you know, darling. 11 years ago, you wouldn't have taken on this Paradine case.
Oh, nonsense. I never turned down a thumping big fee. Then any more than now. Ow!
Oh, you'd have taken it on, but only after sneering for weeks at the decadence of the rich.
I hardly recognize my lost ideals.
I remember the first time you called on me. With two tickets for the first night of that chore play, do you remember? Mm. You'd forgotten to dress. The look of horror on Mother's face as we left the house. It took you 5 years to forgive that parting look.
Took her 50 years to perfect that look.
You seem reasonably dry now. You'd better get dressed.
Darling, I'm not really mental.
I know you're not. If I didn't pretend you were now and then, I couldn't possibly live with so wonderful and brilliant a man.
Oh, I use that sort of talk only on juries.
Does it actually work?
Come here.
No, darling, the Drydens are coming to dinner.
Come here.
No, darling, you're done.
How do you do, Sir Simon?
Well, here's the great man himself, Mrs. Paradine. May I present my colleague, Mr. Keane?
How do you do?
How do you do, Mrs. Paradine?
You may take heart now. We've got the Royal Marines on our side.
You're going to defend me?
Now, the Royal Marines look forward to very little trouble. A brief skirmish and you'll be lunching at the Savoy again.
Really? I haven't been thinking about lunching at the Savoy again.
I know what you've been thinking.
Do you?
Yes. Wild, dark thoughts such as death, where is thy sting? Grave, where is thy victory?
I keep hearing them all the time, saying I married a helpless blind man for his money, and then killed him for his money. And what will they say of Dickie? It makes him out such a fool for loving me.
We'll have answers for whatever they say. You loved him and he needed you.
You know that?
Weren't you his eyes?
I was, of course. I had to be.
Had to be, Mrs. Paradine. Had to be. Dear, dear, you must mind your verbs.
Yes, Sir Simon means that it was a piece of voluntary service. You devoted your whole life to this splendid fellow, freely, gladly.
Oh, yes. Yes, I see what you mean.
It was a sacrifice. A sublime sacrifice.
Yes, I think it would be better to regard it in that light.
It was the more tremendous that Paradine could not understand. Could not possibly understand the sacrifice you were making. He'd never seen you. He'd never, as I say, seen you.
Yes, yes, quite so, quite so. I'm not sure whether Mr. Keane will put you in the witness box or not. But if he does...
Yeah, I don't think we need trouble, Mrs. Paradine, with all that at this stage.
When shall I be seeing you again, Mr. Keane?
Just as soon as I've gone over the details with Sir Simon.
Thank you deeply.
Well, good afternoon.
Thank you for bringing him.
Until the next time, then.
Come along, Keane.
So you think Tony was taken with her, eh, Father?
Well, let's not go on one of your fishing expeditions.
All right, don't tell me. You know, Tony may be as good a lawyer as you think he is, but how he loves anything dramatic. Well, do hold still if you ever want me to get this thing tied.
The impertinence of young people today is simply appalling. If there's one thing I can't abide...
I know, I know. It's impertinence. Can't you just see Tony giving another of his great performances, riding to the rescue of beauty in distress? How he must relish this.
Well, if the case comes up before Hawfield, he better not try one of those performances, or he'll be sat upon and properly. Mm. Good gracious, will they?
Yes, let's hurry, or Hawfield will take it out on poor Sophie. And let's not miss a single word of his lordship's reminiscences. If I hear once more of his gay times in Deauville with Lady So-and-so...
Remarkable old girl, Lady Millicent. We used to have great times together at Deauville back in the 20s. I persuaded her to go in swimming at 70. I watched her frolicking in the surf and had sad thoughts about the impermanence of beauty. My dear, have you swallowed a plumstone or something?
No, Tommy, I'm all right. I thought perhaps... Don't be too long, you men. I always think this is so terribly antiquated, I mean the ladies, but he likes it.
I shan't let him keep us away from you too long.
Give me a call, Father, if the conversation takes an interesting turn.
I see that you haven't forgotten my debut.
Keane is too good a barrister to have forgotten that.
Sometimes I wonder how good you really are, Keane.
Oh, good enough or lucky enough.
Come, 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 no false modesty.
There are not many better, shall we say?
Yes, perhaps, but I am a legalist myself. You, my dear chap, have this habit of overcharging yourself with emotion when facing a jury. I am bound to confess that it does not particularly appeal to my sense of what is proper.
Oh, come, come. Keane's not all that emotional.
Please, Simmy, I do not like to be interrupted in the middle of an insult. Will you have a cigar?
Thank you.
Do you understand, Keane, that all this is simply my concern for you? Will you have a cigar?
No, thank you.
Tommy has a great opinion of your husband, my dear. At least, I think he has. Your husband is very clever, isn't he?
Yes. I think so.
So's mine. I'm not sure that I like it.
Shall I hurry them up? They'll be kicking the good old days around all night if somebody doesn't ring a bell.
I shouldn't be telling you this, but I do so dread it when he has to take a murder trial. He comes home looking so...
Yes, I can well imagine. It must be a terrible nervous strain, trying a capital charge.
Yes, that's it. That's very comforting.
They were retrying Charles I, and Tony got him off.
It's been such a long time. I've been chattering and chattering.
My dear, I'm sure that Keane and Simmy would like to see your jade.
Would they? I have some such pretty pieces.
Very much indeed.
You look very, very appetizing tonight, my dear.
A charming compliment from such a gourmet as yourself, Lord Hawfield.
Tell me, Mrs. Keane, I don't amuse you very much, do I?
No, I've always admired your wit, Lord Hawfield.
Then you may call upon my wit whenever you wish. Life can be very boring for grass widows.
And what makes you think I'm a grass widow?
Well, don't let's be pedantic. Golf widows, stock exchange widows, and law court widows, that's the same thing. It's a charming ruby. Tell me, did your husband earn all that whacking away at juries?
Lady Hawfield was admiring it too. It pleased me so much because she had such excellent taste in most things.
Say, Keane. I'm afraid your wife is wearying of me.
Pity.
Well, why aren't you coming up to bed, darling?
In a little while, dear.
You'll be tired in the morning.
A dull evening, wasn't it?
Yes, no.
I have a murderous day tomorrow. Should never have let Simmy talk me into a new case with all the others I have.
Did you see Mrs. Paradine?
Mm-hmm.
What's she like?
Strangely attractive. I'm sure you'd think so anyway.
Oh, no, I wouldn't.
What do you mean?
She's cost me too much.
Cost you? Well, what on earth are you talking about?
Well, if you don't remember, I'm not going to tell you.
The anniversary and that trip I promised. Well, we'll still make it, my love. Maybe before the case even comes to trial.
It's all right, darling. I'm afraid your excitement is always going to be in the Old Bailey and rather musty old law courts.
No, dear. Honestly, I was thinking just today how much fun it would be to go to Italy.
Italy? I thought we'd plan on going to Switzerland.
I know. But Italy somehow seems so much more colorful. Might go back to Venice. You know, get in a gondola.
Darling.
Oh, what's the matter? What's so amusing?
Nothing. I can't imagine anything more wonderful than being in a gondola again with you.
Well, what is it then?
Well, it's just that you're so... so transparent. And for such a devious kind of barrister, too.
You're pretty devious yourself, don't you think? Come on, tell the jury what's on your mind.
All right. Mrs. Paradine is strangely attractive. And isn't Italy colorful, sir?
Of all the idiotic...
I just thought it might please you to know that I can be jealous.
Well, it isn't that. How can you think that I could be interested in a woman?
Of course you're not interested. I hope you're not getting so old that you can't admire an attractive woman. But I want you to know something. That there are lots of men who find me attractive, too.
Is that so? Who, for instance?
Well, there's Tommy, for instance.
Tommy?
Tommy Horfield. It's getting late, darling. Time we were in the gondola.
Enough for today. Are they treating you well?
Yes, they're very kind.
Do all the books you want, or may I send you any?
No, they have quite a good library here.
Good, good. Very soon I'd like to talk to you about yourself before you met Colonel Paradine.
Will that be necessary?
Oh, it's one of the more annoying parts of this business. The prosecution will always try to tear down the character of the defendant. Naturally, I wouldn't like them to have the advantage of me.
My past is no affair of anyone but my husband and myself. And my husband is dead.
Mrs. Paradine, the character and background of the defendant are of grave importance to the defense. It's my duty to warn you of this.
And how far back will this inquisition go?
Well, as much as I dislike it, I must advise you to convey to me at least anything that you think might be embarrassing. I must say, Mrs. Paradine, that it's essential that I have your cooperation.
Forgive me if I've been difficult. I shall try. It will not shock you, I assume, to learn that I am a woman. What would you say? A woman who has seen a great deal of life.
Mrs. Paradine, please don't mistake my persistence for any lack of sympathy.
When I was still at school in Naples, it began. I was 16. Or so I said. Actually, I was younger.
It's tragic.
Yes, perhaps. But I didn't think so then. I ran away with a man. Istanbul, Athens, Cairo.
He was much older, of course. Rich. He took advantage of your youth.
He was married, respected. I took advantage of him. Then, as suddenly as it began, it ended. He wearied of me, I wearied of him. What difference does it make?
There were others?
Of course, there were others. We cannot hide these things. You said we cannot hide them, Mr. Keane. Let's drag them out. Let them hang me for the past and be done with it.
No, you mustn't feel that. We won't permit them to make anything of it.
Poor Dickie, how he would have hated all this. He gave me his name, his fine name. He depended upon me to protect it.
He knew all about you.
I kept nothing from him. He was so good. He trusted me. He used to sit in the dark, the eternal dark, and weep. The pain never...
I've tortured you enough. We'll get you free. Trust me.
I shall. I do.
Why not let the Crown have the burden of proof of its accusations?
But, Simi, what possible objection can you have to our proving suicide?
I think it's dangerous. Remember, if we have Horfield on the bench...
Oh, you all have such an unholy fear of Horfield.
What's in your mind, Keane? I don't understand you.
Blind men have committed suicide before. We have only to decide who helped Paradine to do it. Here, let me show you something.
Have you ever realized what a lot you can learn from photographs?
Mm-hmm. The social footsteps of time.
You notice anything peculiar?
No, can't say that I do.
And everywhere the Paradines went, the valet was sure to go.
Well, what's so extraordinary about that? The tour worshipped him. Guided Paradines every step, like a mother hen.
It's after midnight.
My darling, I know it's after midnight. In fact, it's after one I heard the clock strike. But I'm not sleepy and I have work to do.
Semi looks dead.
Well, he isn't dead.
Quite right, my dear. I only look dead.
What about some drinks to revive?
Well, that's a good idea. Why don't you have Baker bring
us some? Baker's asleep at this hour, like any civilized person. I'll bring them myself.
That's our man, Simi. I'm sure of it.
Our man? Who? The valet?
Well, who more likely to help Paradine out of his misery?
Forget it. I can't think of anyone less likely.
The devoted, grateful servant and war companion who would do anything to help end his master's agony.
It won't wash, Tony. Let's face it. This wasn't suicide. And it wasn't assisted suicide. It was murder.
Are you trying to imply that Latour might have murdered him?
I'm not talking about Latour.
Who then?
I'm talking about our client.
Oh. So you think she killed him?
It's what the Crown thinks, and we'll try to prove. There's no sense going into court hurling other names into the case. We have to prepare ourselves to answer the Crown on Mrs. Paradine.
I'll have an answer.
With facts?
To begin with, we have the very simple and very obvious fact that Mrs. Paradine is not a murderess.
Really?
She's too fine a woman.
Indeed. I was of the impression that she had been a woman of very low estate and a rather easy virtue.
Oh, you're an insufferable snob, incapable of recognizing genuine character. I only hope the Crown tries to foul her name once, just once.
I'm sorry, I hadn't realized the extent to which she had impressed you.
I've talked to her for hours, and I've done more than hear her words. I've seen the decent, lovely woman behind them, and I intend that the rest of the world shall see her as I do, as a noble, self-sacrificing human being that any man would be proud of.
We've run out of soda water.
Well, ordinary water will do.
Shall I pour yours, Simi?
Please, a strong one.
Worship the Colonel. That's true, isn't it?
Yes.
He was alone with the Colonel a great deal during the day and night.
Yes.
So, if Colonel Paradine, blind, unable to help himself, wanted to die, there was only one person he could turn to, isn't that right?
I won't say that.
You won't say what?
That Andre helped him.
Andre?
Latour.
You'd call him Andre, a valet?
I'm not too well trained in the more subtle snobberies of your class.
My class? I'm afraid you don't know me very well.
I know you. Always ready to sacrifice some underdog to win a point.
You seem extraordinarily eager to protect this man from even suspicion of involvement.
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, you talk about Latour as if...
As if what?
I'm a bit confused. I don't understand your attitude toward Latour. You speak his name oddly.
Oh, this is truly impossible. I'll not listen to any more stupid vicious innuendos. You spoke as my rescuer, talked about a brief skirmish.
So I did. Well, I'll try to recover my position as your champion. We'll drop Monsieur Latour for the time being.
No, I think Keane has given up the idea entirely of dragging the valet into the suicide. At least he hasn't been able to talk Mrs. Paradine into it.
Has he got a substitute? Or is he going to follow your advice for a change?
I don't know. He's turning detective.
What do you mean?
He's going to Cumberland to investigate Henley Hall, a Paradine country house.
But the thing happened in London. Oh, I'm bored with this game. Let's finish it later. The adventures of Anthony Keane are much more interesting.
I don't know how you came by this decidedly unfeminine interest in things. Your mother was a simple, old-fashioned woman who would shudder at the thought of her Well, I'm glad you're not going on with the game. You nearly had me.
Is Tony infatuated with that woman?
What? Where on earth do you get such insane ideas?
Tell me something. How does Hindley Hall happen to be still open?
Oh, it's not really open. There's just the housekeeper. What sort of plot are you concocting now?
Is that handsome valet still there?
I refuse to answer any more questions. If you're not going to play chess, I'm going to write some letters. Now go to bed.
I'll bet you he's going up there because there's something between Mrs. Paradine and that valet.
Valet? Where'd you get that notion?
Why are you looking so funny? Did you have the same idea?
I wondered if Keane could have found out that...
That she and the valet. Well, that's it. And he's jealous. Oh, my heavens, he's jealous of that valet.
Oh, come.
Don't come me. Have you ever known Tony to visit a jail so often for any other client?
Tony is still in love with Gay, and you know it. And why shouldn't he be?
If he lets Gay down after all these years.
Such things do happen. I'm sorry to have to tell you, my dear, that your education, such as it is, was paid for by many a broken heart.
He's in love with that woman, isn't he?
Oh, get off my lap.
Oh, I've never seen it to fail. Men who've been good too long get a longing for the mud and want to wallow in it.
Where'd you read that? Tony's too decent for that sort of thing.
Really? The best men always end up with the worst women. He's after a boyfriend. That's why he's going to Cumberland.
Well, that's absurd.
Don't you think I'm right? Answer me.
I'll not be treated as a hostile witness by my own flesh and blood.
Men are such horrible beasts. I wish I were married to Anthony Keane for just 1 hour. I'd make him jump through hoops.
I wish you were married to someone. Perhaps he could put up with your claptrap better than I can.
I hope... No, I don't hope they hang her. I don't like breaking pretty things. But I do hope they send her to prison for life. What's she really like?
Fascinating. I'm an old ruin, but she certainly brings my pulse up a beat or two.
Poor Gay. Tony.
Hello, darling.
You're late.
Well, I told you not to wait up for me.
I wasn't.
Well, I think I'll be off to bed. Good night, darling.
Tony.
Yes, dear.
I'm sorry if I don't seem quite myself. It's that I have a headache.
Oh, sorry that you're not feeling well. I'm afraid I'm a bit on the ragged side myself tonight.
Tony, couldn't we get away just for a little while? You do need a rest. I've never seen you quite like this before.
Oh, I'll be all right. Just a good night's sleep.
Even if it's only for a few days. For our anniversary. You did promise that.
Really, darling, there are some things more important than anniversaries.
You didn't used to think so.
As a matter of fact, I may have to go away. Mrs. Paradine and her husband used to live a good deal of the time at a place called Hindley Hall up in Cumberland. I thought I might nose around a bit. You know, see what I could pick up. At the same time, get a breath of fresh air.
Well, that sounds wonderful. You won't be busy all the time and we can...
Well, darling, it's only for a day or two.
Oh.
Well, it wouldn't be any fun for you. You see that, don't you?
Yes, I see.
Might be cold and wet up north.
Yes, I suppose so.
Well, this is the place for you. Warm, cozy, protected. I want to keep all this ugly business away from you.
But can you?
Well, can I what?
Keep the ugliness away?
Haven't I always? What do you mean? What are you afraid of?
Need I say?
Listen, darling, this settles it. Nothing is worth this kind of trouble between us. I won't go to Cumberland. I won't go on with the case at all. I'll give up the brief.
Tony.
I mean it. Simmy can get someone else.
But what will she say?
What the devil is it? Matter what she says. Well, the case isn't so difficult. Any one of 50 men can handle it. Isn't that what you wanted? We'll leave for Switzerland. We'll leave next Sunday. Tomorrow, perhaps.
Darling.
Well, what's the matter now?
Nothing's the matter. Just thank you. Thank you for being so good. I knew my old Tony couldn't have changed quite that much.
Well, what do you say? Lucerne or St. Moritz?
No, darling, neither. You're going up to Cumberland, and then you're coming back to your office, and then you're going into court.
Oh, no, I am tired. That's what you said, and you're right.
You're not too tired, Tony. You're not too tired. There aren't 50 men who can save her. There's only one Anthony Keane.
You've always had such big ideas about me.
No, darling, I haven't. Besides, I have a stake in this, too.
I don't know what you mean.
I wouldn't like a woman to be hanged, any woman, just because my husband had a rendezvous with her. In jail.
Okay.
Let's go to bed, darling. No, not now.
Well, you'll come up to Cumberland with me.
I'll be waiting here, cozy, comfortable, and protected. Good night, darling.
Good night. Sitting room?
Oh, yes, sir. You mentioned it in your wire. Would you be wanting to see it?
Yes, please.
Would you like some cold fish and salad before you go to bed?
Oh, no, thank you. But any chance of a whiskey and soda?
Okie doke. Your bedroom's number 17. I'll have your bag sent up.
Thank you.
Are you a detective?
No, why?
Oh, I just wondered.
Well, why do you ask? Have you had trouble here?
Well, no, not exactly here, but, well, we don't like being in the Sunday papers. Haven't you heard about the big poisoning case? That was Colonel Paradine. He had Hindley Hall. Oh, mercy me, your fire's going out.
Yes, I heard about that.
This chimney won't draw. We found a dead owl in it last Sunday. Hey, that murder's been the talk of the place. It was Mrs. Paradine that did it, they say. Oh, that's better. The sticks were damp and the wind's in the wrong way.
Did you know her?
Nobody knew her. Oh, she'd ride over here once in a while on a black hunter. Pleasant enough, but she never spoke to no one.
Did she always ride alone?
That's got it. Yes. Now I've come to think of it, she always was alone. And now the poor colonel's dead and the house is up to let.
I heard it was. That's why I came, as a matter of fact.
Oh, that's why you're here, Mr. Keane. I was wondering, are you going to see the house tomorrow?
Yes, I think so.
Well, would you mind going in a pony and trap? Our car's all booked up for tomorrow. It's only about 8 miles.
Fine. Make it about 10 o'clock.
Okie doke.
Up there yonder in those trees is the hall, sir. Where the poor colonel lived. Many's the time I've seen him walking around here, blind as he was, with Andre.
Andre?
Andre Latour, colonel's body servant. A queer one.
Is anyone living at the Hall now?
Only the caretaker, Mrs. Carr. Maybe Andrew's back from London now. They say he knows more about the poor Colonel's death than he'll tell. He's a queer one, all right.
In what way?
Oh, I don't know. He keeps himself to himself. Perhaps it's because he's foreign. They never seem quite the same, do they, sir? Tour. Here's a gentleman from London come up with an order to see over the Hall.
I'm interested in renting the house.
In renting the house, Mr. Keane? Will you come in, please?
If you'll wait here, Mr. Keane, I'll open the shutters.
He might and he might not, sir. Will you step this way?
This is the morning room. It was the poor colonel's favorite room. It has a fine view, sir. He loved to ever describe it to him. Every time the seasons changed.
Didn't she?
I'll show you the upstairs, sir. And this was her room, sir. I'm sorry it's so untidy, sir. I was packing up her things. If you'll excuse me, sir, I'll open up the other rooms.
I should like to see the gardens. Would you take me around?
Very good, sir.
Immediately. We won't bother about the other rooms now. Latour's going to show me the gardens.
Very well, sir.
What door is that?
It's Latour's room.
Why wasn't he in the servants' quarters?
She felt he should be near the colonel.
Well, I may drop in again tomorrow. Where's the tour?
I'm sure I couldn't say, sir.
But he was to show me the garden.
He was called away.
All right. Back to the inn.
Can I have a word with you, sir?
Come in. What can I do for you?
It is not a question very easy to answer.
How did you know that this was my room?
I saw you come up from the lakeshore, and then this light go on.
You've been watching the inn for some time?
Yes, I walked over from Hindley.
To see me?
Yes, sir. It came to my mind it would be well to see you.
Sit down. Why didn't you come to the front door? What was your object in coming in the back way?
They'd all gone to bed, sir, and I didn't want to disturb the household.
But you might have come earlier.
I didn't care to come earlier, sir.
Why not?
I leave that to you, sir.
What is it you want with me?
Beg pardon, sir, but I thought it was you wanted to see me.
What caused you to think that?
Well, you came to the hall.
I didn't come to the hall to see you. I didn't know you were there. I came to see the house.
But you asked me to show you over the garden.
Yes. And you said you would, and then you shot out of sight like a rabbit. Why?
I don't know. I think first... No, I do not want to talk to him. And then I think perhaps I'm wrong.
And remember this, Latour. You forced yourself on me. I didn't seek you out. You're apparently going to be a very hostile witness in this case. You're not one of my witnesses. And it would be most improper for me to try to establish contact with you. I came on you entirely by chance.
But you wanted to come on me, sir.
You choose to say so, but it so happens that it's my business, my job, to save the life of your former mistress.
Beg pardon, sir. She was not my mistress. Colonel Paradine was my master.
I have it your own way.
I would never have served a woman. It is not in my character to do that.
I insist upon knowing what was your reason for wanting to see me tonight.
And if you tell me why you came all the way from London, I'll tell you why I came here.
Oh. So it's to be a bargain, is it? Why should I make a bargain with you?
Call it what you like, sir. All I say is, you tell me and I'll tell you. Seems fair enough to me.
Cigarette?
No, thank you, sir.
You don't smoke?
I won't smoke, sir. Thank you. I know why you wanted to see me. She sent you.
She? Mrs. Paradine doesn't even know that I'm here. She had nothing to do with my coming.
It seems I'm wrong, then.
Why would she send me?
She might have her reasons.
I don't know what they might be.
But perhaps you don't know her as I do.
Mrs. Paradine is my client. I know her as her lawyer. That's sufficient for me.
You may not think it. That you're on the wrong side, sir. And I tell you so.
What do you mean exactly by that? You'd better make yourself clear.
Excuse me, sir. You have only known Mrs. Paradine since she is in prison. Is it not so?
Yes.
Then how can you know her? If you did, I should not need to tell you that only Almighty God or the Black Devil himself knows what's going on in that head of hers.
I won't hear anything more against her.
I know what I'm talking about. What I say is true. I know her. And I will tell you one thing more. I will tell you about Mrs. Paradine. She's bad, bad to the bone. If ever there was an evil woman, she is one.
Would you mind getting out of here? I don't want any dirty, lying sneaks in my room. Get out!
Very good, sir, as you wish. If you'll allow me, sir, I'm very sorry for you. And God help you.
You'd forgotten me.
Well, I've been out of London for a few days. I went up to Hindley Hall.
Why did you go there?
Well, I thought it might help me to know more about your background. I walked on the terrace, went into the house, into your room. I saw Latour. He behaved very strangely. At first he avoided me, then he forced himself on me. Came to my room at the inn late at night.
Why did he do that?
He wanted to talk to me. About you.
Indeed. And what did my husband's valet have to say about me?
Don't, I beg of you, don't behave this way with me.
I don't know what you mean.
Latour hates you. You know that? He hates you most bitterly. He said you're an evil woman. Do you know what he meant by that? This man despises you. Why?
He despises all women.
Oh, what's the good of telling me that? It's you he hates, not all women. And the jury will find a reason why he hates you, because of something that you might have done to his master. Can't you see that?
Of course I see. You needn't explain these things to me as though I were a child.
Listen to me. I want to save you. I want to fight for you, but I can't like this in the dark. I can't sleep, I can't work, I can't think.
I don't understand you.
All right. Is it possible that Latour hates you because you made him disloyal to his master?
That's enough, Mr. Keane.
What existed between you and Latour?
I will not be treated in this manner by my own counsel. I should prefer that you give up the case.
Oh, no, I must save you. No one else can. My personal feelings are such that...
You must forgive me if I regard my life as more important.
I apologize. Deeply. If you'll forgive me, I shall do my best to defend you.
I am a little tired. I think you also are a little tired.
Tony back from Gomorrah?
I'm sorry, Judy. What did you say?
Just making conversation. I asked whether Tony was back from Cumberland.
He was due back this morning. I haven't seen him yet. Give me a cigarette, will you, Judy?
When did you start smoking?
Oh, just lately.
Poor father, I'm afraid he's failed with me in every way.
What do you mean?
20 years he's been telling me, do not ask questions, leave others to tell you if they choose. Only vulgar people probe.
You're my best friend, Judy. Ask anything you wish. You must know what everyone is saying. I know it's probably exaggerated. And would it surprise you very much, Judy, to know that he wanted to give up the case? Surprise me? It would absolutely floor me. Why didn't he then? Because I wouldn't let him. Suppose someone else had taken up the case. It would have been won or lost. Either way, the little romance of Gay and Tony Keane would have been ended forever. Perhaps so. Judy, darling, just because a man, a husband, fancies some other woman, you don't treat him as a criminal. You don't. I doubt if you would either. It's very painful, but it's painful for him, too. He's very fond of me, and I'd like to keep him so. Even if it means letting him go. No, simply by not making him suffer too much for hurting me. After all, I don't own him. I only love him.
Hello, Vicar. Mrs. Keane at home?
I'm in here, Tony.
Hello, darling.
You're just in time for tea.
Come pour me a cup, will you?
How was the journey?
Oh, not very interesting. You're doing your hair a new way.
No. You've seen it like this hundreds of times. Would you rather I didn't talk?
What do you mean?
Well, nothing at all. It's just you look a bit tired.
No, no, there's really nothing to tell you, dear. It's a big house. It's rather what you'd expect. You know the Lake District.
Oh, Tony.
What is it you want to know about, dear?
Nothing. Actually, I... Shall we dine early, or would you like to sleep for a bit?
I suppose you hate her, don't you?
Let's not talk about it, Tony. I'm trying hard, and I'm hoping that...
You're hoping that I'll lose the case. I wouldn't blame you, darling. No matter what you hoped for.
You've been my life, Tony, and for such a long time. Do you think I could ever want anything bad for you?
No, I suppose not.
I won't deny that there have been moments when I've wished the worst for her. It's not easy to face the thought of losing you. We've been really married, really truly married, as few people have been. Yes, I've lain awake, alone, night after night. And I've been tempted to pray that she... But I've come to a conclusion, Tony. I want her to live. I want very much for her to live. And I hope she gets free, scot-free, free to kill. Or to take other wives' husbands, or do anything else that comes into that beautiful head of hers.
I don't understand. You can't really care what happens to her.
But I do. I care very much. Well, not for any noble reasons. I do hate her. But because I want all this business over and done with, and an end to your being all mixed up, part lawyer, part lover.
What nonsense. Nonsense.
All right, frustrated lover, then. Yes, and part husband still, because you're not finished with me. You wouldn't have come back home today if you were. I've seen your torture, and
I've loved you all the more for letting it torture you. I know the depth of your feelings for me.
Yes, Kate.
I know it, and I'm counting on it. All I ask is that she lives so the fight can be an even one. Because if she dies, you're lost to me forever. I know you'll go on thinking that you love her. You'll go on imagining her as your great lost love. May I tell you something, Tony? You don't love her. No, you don't. I may not be the cleverest woman in the world, and there are lots of things I don't know. But there's one thing I know better than anyone else. I know you.
Oh, my dear, if only I
don't want you to say anything. But I do ask you for the most brilliant job of your entire career. I want you to win this case. I want you to get her free. I've made my speech. What a speech. That's what comes of being married to a lawyer. I'm going up to change now. You coming along, darling?
Yes, in a minute.
Are you ready, Mrs. Paradine?
Silence. All persons who have anything further to do before the Lords, the King's Justices, Lawyer and Terminal, and General Jail Delivery, for the jurisdiction of the Central Criminal Court, draw near and give your attendance.
Wait here.
God save the King.
Bring forth the prisoner. Maddalena Anna Paradine, you're charged with the murder of Richard Patrick Irving Paradine on May the 6th last. Are you guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty.
Oh, but Gay, darling, I don't see how you can possibly stay away. Oh, no, Tony won't be able to see you. We'll be in the gallery, just two more dim faces.
On the night of May the 6th, at a time we may be able to fix within the compass of a few minutes, some persons or person administered to Richard Paradine a murderous dose of poison. For at 9:30, he was heard calling for help. And a few minutes later, he died painfully, before he could be reached by his old comrade at arms and faithful servant, André Latour. You will hear that on the night of May the 6th, a quarrel took place in which the participants were Colonel Paradine, Mrs. Paradine, and André Latour. The colonel, being in a very agitated state, shut himself up in his bedroom alone. The butler took his dinner up to him, a dinner consisting of roast chicken, roast potatoes, and cauliflower au gratin. Later, he asked that a single glass of burgundy should be put by his bedside so that he would know exactly where to feel for it. A single glass of burgundy, ladies and gentlemen.
Farrell's off to a good start.
You're aware of the colonel's character. He was a man cast in heroic mold. One looks back on his life with humility and pride. He was like a reincarnation from the spacious days of Queen Elizabeth. Incredibly daring, illimitably adventurous. And this man of dynamic energy, is doomed suddenly to darkness and the life of a helpless invalid. Members of the jury, we must surely pity this woman, chained as she was to a ruined giant who was burning with a dreadful resentment. One could forgive an occasional outburst or demonstration of impatience from her. But the odd thing, ladies and gentlemen, is that outwardly this woman was a model of patience. But heaven knows what sultry fires were banked within. It would have been a considerable strain to any ordinary woman, no doubt. But this woman, the prosecution contend, is no ordinary woman. She had patience. She could wait. This was indeed no ordinary woman.
Now, Laker, you have said that after you served dinner to Colonel Paradine in his bedroom, he asked you to place a glass of burgundy by his bedside. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Would you call that a suitable bedtime drink, you as a butler?
No, sir, I would not. But the Colonel...
Answer my questions, please. Had he ever asked for a glass of burgundy to be put by his bedside before?
No, sir, not that I can remember.
Did he usually drink burgundy?
It usually didn't agree with him, sir. But sometimes...
That will do.
He's building a suicide motive.
One moment, Lakin. I think you told the jury that Colonel Paradine did not usually take burgundy because it disagreed with him. Did he dislike burgundy?
Oh, no, my lord. On the contrary.
He was very fond of burgundy, but seldom dared take it.
Yes, my lord, that is correct.
Hoverfield's killed that point. What do you mean? By making it clear there was nothing so extraordinary about his drinking burgundy.
I was anxious that the point should be clear, Mr. Keane.
Well, thank you, my lord. I'm obliged to your lordship.
No questions, my lord. Call André Latour.
André Latour.
Take the testament in your right hand and repeat the oath.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Your name?
André Etienne Latour.
Your age?
30.
You were born, I believe, in Montreal, Canada, and you served in the war with Colonel Paradine.
Yes, sir. I was his manservant before the war. And later I had the honor of serving under his command.
You won the Distinguished Conduct Medal and Bar for gallantry in the field.
That is so, sir.
At the time of Colonel Paradine's death, you were employed as his valet and confidential companion.
Yes, sir.
Well, speak up, Latour, so that we can all hear you. You were very much attached to Colonel Paradine, were you not?
He was the best man I ever knew in all my life.
At about 8 o'clock, you heard the bell ringing violently. You went upstairs to the Colonel's room. You saw the Colonel and Mrs. Paradine facing each other. What happened then?
He looked at me for a minute, in his blind way, and then burst out with it.
Try to give us his exact words.
He said, "Do I understand you're going to leave me? Now, when I need you most?" I asked him who told him such a thing. He said, "She did."
Did he say anything else?
He was very angry. He used strong language.
Had you any intention of leaving him?
No, sir.
Do you know of any reason why Mrs. Paradine should have told her husband that you were leaving him?
She wanted to get rid of me.
You told us yesterday, Latour, that when you went back up to see the Colonel, you saw Mrs. Paradine in the hallway outside the bedroom. You're certain of that?
Yes, sir.
Where is that plan? I have here a plan of the house. The upper floor. Is it your impression that the lady was passing directly from Colonel Paradine's bedroom to her own?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. That'll be all for the time being.
Latour lied like mad about the quarrel. He's keeping something back.
Does the name of Margaret Wells convey anything to you?
Yes, sir.
What does that name convey to you? I must try to help your memory. I put it to you that some years ago you were engaged to Margaret Wells of Three Rivers, Quebec. That on your wedding day she left you at the church door and went off with a saddler named Richard Truton.
That is finished. That is in the past.
Your question may be relevant, Mr. Keane. Its relevance escapes me.
My lord, I submit that the witness has shown, in his evidence and also in his behavior, an almost pathological bias against not only my client, but against all women.
I may be stupid, but I fail to understand what this jilting has to do with the case. After seeing the witness and observing his appearance and bearing, I should be inclined to regard the young lady's conduct as pathological, not his.
Silence!
Proceed to your next question.
Very good, my lord. If I'm not to be allowed to show one of the reasons for the witness's hostile attitude towards my client. Were you aware that Colonel Paradine made a will in which he bequeathed you the sum of £3,500? Come, come, it's a simple question of fact.
Colonel Paradine told me he might leave me a little something, but I didn't know about the will, sir.
You mean he told you he was going to leave you this legacy, but you doubted his word?
No, sir, I did not doubt his word.
Then you believed it?
Yes, sir.
Believing it, then you knew and believed that you would receive such a legacy on his death. Please answer the question.
I don't know what you ask.
You are being asked if you knew that you were to inherit £3,500 from Colonel Paradine if and when he died.
We never discussed it. I didn't think about it. Yes, I knew.
Now, you don't remember very easily, do you, Latour? Now, please think carefully before you reply to this. And remember that you were on your oath. When you were in London, did you or did you not repeatedly hear Colonel Paradine say that he wished to be dead?
That he wished he was dead, sir?
That he wished to be dead. André Latour, on your solemn oath, do you deny having heard Colonel Paradine say again and again to you and in your hearing that he was sick of life and wished to be dead?
He said a lot of things when he was angry about his blindness. I got so accustomed to them, I didn't take much notice.
You didn't take much notice? You did not take much notice. Very well. Would you tell the court, please, exactly what happened along about 8 o'clock on the evening of May the 6th?
You mean you want me to go over my evidence again?
No, Latour, I do not want you to go over your evidence again. But did you not stand in that box and swear by Almighty God, as you should stand before him on the great day of judgment, that you would tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Did you?
Yes, sir.
Very well. I put it to you that your evidence was a tissue of lies. I put it to you that you were trying to cover up what really happened. There is another person in this court who was there, who knew what happened. Remember that.
Mr. Keane, what is your question?
Do you still wish to allege that Mrs. Paradine invented a cock and bull story about your leaving the Colonel's service and that this precipitated the quarrel?
Yes, sir, she did.
It would be her word against yours now.
Yes, sir, and so it was then with the Colonel.
You are then asking his lordship and the jury to believe that after years of devoted service in the field and in the sick chamber, that you were in this position, that Colonel Paradine had absolutely no faith in your word of honor? I put it to you, Latour, that your story is a pack of lies. Do you persist in it?
If she says the contrary, she'd better...
What was that you started to say?
Answer the question.
I Stick to what I said.
If you don't mind, Latour, I should like to go over that night with you again, in case any small incidents have slipped your memory. After the butler, Lakin, took the colonel his dinner, where were you?
In my room.
To tell you about putting the glass of burgundy at the colonel's bedside?
Yes.
Or was that not unusual?
Maybe so.
No maybe about it. Was it or wasn't it?
It was, sir.
And after he had told you this, then you went upstairs again?
Yes.
Why?
I had no special reason, sir.
Well, shortly before, the colonel had denounced you in strong language for deserting him. And yet you went upstairs for no special reason?
I was unhappy about being on bad terms with him.
What's that? Speak up. The jury can't hear you.
I wanted to make it up with the colonel.
Well, very well. You knocked at the colonel's door and went in.
I knocked on his door. I did not go in.
Very well, you knocked. And what happened then?
The colonel told me to go away.
He told you to go away without even knowing who was knocking?
No, sir, no. He asked who it was, and I told him. Then he told me to go away.
Ah, you're very sharp, Latour. Tell me, what manner of tone did the colonel use?
Sir?
When he told you to go, to get away from him.
My lord, when Latour gave his evidence in chief, the words used by him were, the colonel told me to go away, not get away from me.
Oh, go away, get away from me, what's the difference?
My learned friend is sufficient of an artist to appreciate the difference in shades of meaning, and I prefer that he be accurate in these matters.
It's a point of no importance. Make it go away if you like.
Mr. Keane, one moment, please. Counsel for the Crown is right in his contention. I agree that you should be more careful.
If your lordship pleases, I'll continue the cross-examination. Arthur, you used to help the colonel get to bed, did you not?
Yes, sir.
Quite a complicated matter, getting a blind man to bed. Didn't everything have to be made ready? His toothbrush, his pajamas, hot water bottle?
Yes, sir.
And yet you did not enter the room, not even to see that Lakin had put the glass of burgundy in the right place where the colonel wouldn't knock it over by mistake when reaching for it?
I wasn't thinking about the burgundy.
Very well. You were wondering what to do to make it up with the colonel, and you were very much upset. Is that putting it fairly?
Yes, I think so.
You have stated that you saw someone else in the hall?
Yes, sir, Mrs. Paradine.
And what was she doing?
Going into her bedroom.
Well, Mrs. Paradine's bedroom was directly across the hall from the colonel's bedroom, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
At the moment when you saw Mrs. Paradine, had you the remotest idea where she'd come from?
No, sir.
She might even have come out from her room, seen you, and turned to go back in again.
It is possible.
But she could not have come out from the colonel's room without going around you. Or through you. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, you saw Mrs. Paradine go into her room and shut the door. And what did you do then?
Nothing. I hung about for a minute or two. And then I...
What was your purpose in hanging about for a minute or two?
I didn't have any purpose, sir. I just... Well, I just didn't know what to do. And then I decided to go downstairs.
Tell me, Latour. Have you ever seen anyone die by poison?
No, sir.
Or any animal?
No, sir.
Wasn't there an old dog put away by poison at Hindley about 2 years ago?
Yes, I beg your pardon, sir. I almost forgot.
Yes, so we noticed. It was killed by poison, wasn't it?
Yes, sir. It was the colonel's old hunting dog. He was sick. So we put him away, you see?
You mean you put him away?
Yes, sir.
And what poison did you use?
I don't know, sir.
You don't know? Did you keep any of it?
Oh, no, sir. We got the single dose from the vet.
Don't keep on saying we. You mean you did?
Yes, sir.
It wasn't a big dose.
No, sir. Very small.
And it acted very quickly.
Yes, it did. I understand what you mean to say. He's accusing me of poisoning my colonel! But I didn't!
I must ask the witness to collect himself and...
But it's not true, I tell you! I didn't do it! How could I?
I must again caution the witness to confine himself to answering questions. He is not on trial. It is quite unnecessary for him to make protestations of innocence concerning actions with which he has not been charged. And I think, Mr. Keane, this will be a convenient opportunity to adjourn. We will resume at 2:05.
I swear by Almighty God that I shall well and truly keep this jury in some private and convenient place, with such accommodation as the court shall direct. I will not suffer any person to speak to them, neither will I speak to them myself, touching the trial held here this day, unless it be to ask them if they're agreed upon their verdict, without leave of the court.
Johnny.
Keane!
Tony's torn him to pieces. It was horrible. But darling, you've got to remember it's Tony's job.
Well, it's gone well for us this morning, really well.
Has it?
Well, surely you must know that.
I'm not a lawyer.
Oh, good heavens, you're a clever woman. Don't you realize how I shook him?
You have not kept faith with me.
What do you mean?
I did not agree to what you have done today.
But
I objected when you wanted to make it appear that Andre had helped my husband kill himself. I objected even to that. And now you make him out to be a murderer. Now I will not forgive you for what you have done today.
Forgive me? Well, I've exhausted myself. Destroying everything in an effort to save him.
I did not ask you to do that.
Forgive me. You forgive me. I was idiot enough to fall in love with you. Did you hear that?
If it's true, how could you deceive me as you've done today?
Look, the case has narrowed itself down to this. One of three things. Either your husband managed somehow to poison himself, or Latour did it, or you did.
As you like. But I will not have you making Andre a murderer.
Are you in love with him?
What has that to do with it? You're my lawyer, not my lover.
Yes. Someone else said something very like that to me recently.
I should like to know whether you intend to continue with the case.
Yes, of course. I'm planning to cut out all the witnesses except you. I'm going to rely on your evidence in my final speech to save you.
I know I can't trust you. I feel it.
Yes, you can trust me.
You will save me, but not at his expense. You understand that, don't you?
I suppose that's the only way to save you.
You are not to destroy him. If you do, I shall hate you as I've never hated a man.
I must go on the way I've begun. I must act according to my own view. You can do what you like. I've not finished with the tour yet. After that, I shall put you into the box. You can say what you like there. My questions will be mine, your answers yours. Now, Latour. You remember your evidence? During the quarrel, the colonel used strong language with you?
Yes, sir.
Did he discharge you?
I didn't know what to think. It was all a lie she told about my
leaving. Yes, yes, we've heard about that. Did you assume that you were discharged?
Yes, sir. Suppose so.
Aren't you aware that Mrs. Paradine is the mistress of Hindley Hall?
Yes, sir.
Well, let me review things for you, Latour. You supposed that you were discharged by the colonel, yet you continued in the employ of the woman who allegedly lied about you to your master? Well, answer me, Latour.
I felt I wanted to help take care of the colonel's estate. There was nowhere else to go, so...
Yes, yes. Do I understand, Latour, that after the quarrel on the night of May 6th, you never again saw Colonel Paradine alive?
Yes, sir.
But you did see him dead?
Yes, sir.
When?
After Dr. Young left, I was told to clean up the room.
Who gave you these instructions?
She did.
Whom do you mean by she?
Mrs. Paradine.
While you were cleaning up the room, did you notice the wine glass?
Yes, sir.
Did it still contain the burgundy?
There were only a few drops in the bottom of the glass.
Oh, you say that there were a few drops left in the bottom of the glass?
Yes, sir.
If you were told that Dr. Young had examined the glass after he had discovered that Colonel Paradine was dead, that he'd examined the glass and found it to be clean, that it had been washed and dried, would you still hold to your statement that there were a few drops of burgundy remaining in the bottom of the glass?
Yes, sir, I still say the same thing.
When did you wash and dry that glass, Latour?
I never washed or dried that glass. I never touched it. I left it just where it was.
You stated that it was Mrs. Paradine who sent you in to clean up the room.
Yes, sir.
But after she sent you into the room, the glass of burgundy was not yet washed.
Yes, sir.
Then it could not have been Mrs. Paradine who washed the glass.
Really, my lord, all this is most improper. I simply must insist that these questions be kept within bounds.
Yes, I noticed that the learned counsel was tending to make points rather than ask questions, but I was reluctant to interfere, knowing how he resents interruption.
Latour, are you aware of the penalty for perjury? Answer me.
I've told the truth.
I put it to you, André Latour, that Colonel Paradine had a reason for his rage with you that fatal night. A reason that had nothing to do with the trumped-up story that you've told in this court. Was it at Hindley Hall or in London that you first gave Mrs. Paradine occasion to complain about your attentions?
It's not true. She never did.
And was she not at last forced to go to her husband and beg him to dismiss you from his service?
I won't stand here and listen to these filthy lies.
And was that, in fact, the cause, and the only cause, of the terrible scene which took place on the night of Colonel Paradine's death?
No, she can't say that.
The Colonel knew, didn't he? Knew because she told him. Isn't that the truth? Answer the question.
I will not answer.
Why, because you don't want to admit that he trusted you and you betrayed him?
No, I did not. She can't breed on me. She has told you lies and I hate her.
Because she told her husband about you?
No, she did not. He found out.
Then you mean he heard you speaking improperly to his wife?
Yes.
My lord, I finished with the witness.
I didn't want to tell about it. I didn't want to hurt his good name. But you have spoken. You and she. Both of you. So I too will speak now.
I am finished with the witness.
Oh, Tony.
It was she who dragged us both down. I hated every moment with her. But God forgive me. Couldn't help myself.
My lord, this man is a confessed perjurer. Must the jury listen to this rubbish?
Mr. Keane.
He's finally been forced to tell the truth and is now trying to involve my client in his treachery.
Mr. Keane, might I remind you that this is not the first time that you have been responsible for an over-emotional atmosphere in court. I cannot blame the witness for his behavior.
My lord, with all respect, I submit that a transcript of this man's evidence be sent to the Director of Public Prosecutions with a view to formulation of charges of perjury, which he certainly has committed. And whether to such a charge might not also be added one of murder.
Mr. Keane, you seem anxious to usurp the duties of the judge in this case.
Proceed, Sir Joseph.
Latour, in testifying as to what was heard by Colonel Paradine,
are you implying that you engaged in an adulterous relationship with Mrs. Paradine?
Yes. You know now what I did. I can't live with the memory of what I've done.
I'm afraid I must ask you to bear with a few more questions. Did you avoid the truth
because of your feelings about this woman?
Yes, I lied. Because I didn't want the world to know what she was. His wife, my colonel's wife.
And also because you cared for her?
I don't know how to say it. I tried not to, but...
That is all, Latour. My lord, that concludes the case for the prosecution.
Members of the jury, the woman who is before you in the dock is a foreigner, friendless and alone in a strange country. But a country that, thank heaven, has always prided itself on its passion for justice. I had intended to call before you numerous witnesses on her behalf. To speak of her character, of her self-sacrifice. A sacrifice made cheerfully by a beautiful woman while still fascinating and still young, in order to bring the light of her affection into the darkness of a blinded man's life. But after hearing the case for the Crown, we find so little to rebut that we have decided to call no witnesses, members of the jury, except the prisoner.
He hasn't lost his nerve, I'll say that for him.
When she has been heard, I am confident that the decision of the jury will be not guilty. I will now ask the prisoner to go into the box. Absolutely certain that when she leaves it, there will be nothing left of the stain which the prosecution, as I hope to show, has so recklessly and unjustifiably sought to place upon her character. I call the prisoner Maddalena Paradine.
Hold the testament in your right hand and repeat the oath.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
If you wish, you may be seated while giving your evidence.
No, thank you, my lord.
What is your name?
Maddalena Anna Paradine.
And you're the widow of Richard Patrick Irving Paradine.
I am.
And what were your circumstances when you married him?
I was very poor. My life had been unpleasant and unattractive.
Truthful, isn't she? Very clever of Tony, you mean. He's just disarming the other side.
Had you no fear at the thought of spending your life with a blind man?
I thought it a splendid opportunity.
Opportunity?
Yes, I thought I will be his eyes.
Well, did you find it difficult to care for a blind man, to take care of him?
No.
He was never unkind to you?
Sometimes, but I understood. It was terrible for him being like that. It was easy to forgive him.
On the night of your husband's death, a quarrel took place at your London home in your husband's room?
Yes.
Will you tell the jury, please, what was the cause of that quarrel?
I had spoken to my husband about his van at Latour. I asked my husband to find another place for him.
Why was that?
Answer the question.
I did not wish Latour to stay in the house.
And why didn't you wish Latour to stay in the house?
I preferred that he shouldn't be there.
But why?
I did not like his manner with me.
What was there in Latour's manner that you disliked?
I thought it sometimes too familiar.
Will you please explain exactly what you mean by that?
He took liberties.
Did he try to make love to you? Please answer. Did he try to make love to you?
Yes.
And you complained about it to your husband?
I did.
Now, Mrs. Paradine, you've heard Latour's version of the quarrel in your husband's room on the night of May the 6th. What actually did happen when Latour came into the room?
My husband swore at him and said, "You have insulted my wife."
And what did Latour say to that?
He broke down and said, He said that if my husband would forgive him, it would never happen again.
Well, then Latour's version of what took place is completely untrue.
My lord, I object. My learned friend is once more deliberately putting words into the mouth of a witness.
I was merely asking a question.
The form was objectionable, and I'm anxious not to intervene again, Mr. Keane. Am I being clear?
Your lordship always makes his meanings perfectly clear.
Then kindly attend to my ruling, and do not let me have further cause to repeat it.
I hope I shall always take note of the ruling of a learned judge, however much I may disagree with it.
Do not bandy words with me, Mr. Keane. Kindly go on with your examination of the witness.
Mrs. Paradine, after your husband's death, you sent Latour into the colonel's room to tidy it up?
Yes.
Was anyone with you when you sent Latour into the room?
Dr. Young.
Was Dr. Young still with you when Latour came out of the room?
Yes.
Have you heard of Dr. Young's deposition stating that after he left you, he went to your husband's room and found the glass washed and dried?
I've heard that, yes.
Well, then is this not true, that the only person who could have washed and dried that glass is Latour?
My lord,
all right, all right. Could anyone else have washed and dried it?
I know what you're trying to make me say. You're trying to make people think that André Latour killed my husband.
Silence.
I asked you whether anyone else could have washed and dried the glass.
Yes.
What do you mean by yes?
I did.
It's my duty to warn you that you have made a very serious admission. Would you like to make some explanation of it to the jury?
My lord, with the utmost respect, I would like to request that I'd be given time to consider this turn of events. This piece of evidence is entirely new to me.
Keane, it is getting rather late, and we have had a very trying session. Would it be convenient to you if we adjourned now?
I would be greatly obliged to your lordship.
Very well, we will adjourn until tomorrow morning at 10:30.
Are you sure you won't stay for dinner, Judy?
No, Gay, I really can't. I promised Father. Good night, dear.
Hello, Tony.
Oh, hello. Oh, what the devil are you looking so sad about?
Nothing. I was there today.
Was Gay with you?
Yes.
Was that your idea?
Yes.
Oh, I suppose you'll have your usual expert comment to make on the conduct of the case.
Yes.
Well, that will most certainly be helpful. Precisely what I need at this moment.
If she washed the wine glass...
She didn't.
I hope the jury agrees with you.
She's trying to cover up for that dirty swine. If she did wash the glass, it's because she knew he killed Paradine. If I had access to her while she's a witness, I'd make her say so tonight.
Tony, you won't get angry if I ask you something else, will you?
Well, will it make any difference if I do?
Why are you hammering away at that quarrel in the bedroom? That's what made her say what she did.
All right, if you really want to know, if your father wants to know, because I want to get at the motive.
Oh?
Latour's motive. He was in love with her. He wanted to get rid of her husband.
What about your motive?
What do you mean?
Well, you know, and I know, and Gay knows why it is that you think Latour is the murderer. But you wouldn't have handled her that way in the box for any other reason. You treated her as though you were cross-examining a witness for the prosecution.
Now, look here.
Oh, Tony, it's true. It's terribly true. What? Somebody's got to show you. You've got to save this woman for Gay's sake.
If you'll leave me alone, perhaps I still can.
If you're left to your own devices, I'll bet you one thing. Mrs. Paradine will be done for, and your career along with it. And if it weren't for Gay, I wouldn't be so sure that that would be a very bad thing either. Good night.
My lord, I've finished with the witness.
That's funny.
nothing. I'll tell you about it later.
Mrs. Paradine, did you think André Latour very handsome?
Of course not. He is a servant. How could I consider him in that way?
These attentions on the part of Latour had gone on for some time.
Yes.
Why did you wait until that night to tell your husband about the matter?
I was ashamed.
Why should you be ashamed? Was it your fault?
Of course not.
Then why be ashamed? Was it your modesty that held you back? Remembering your past, would you say that?
My lord, I protest against that insinuation. There's been nothing in the evidence that reflects on the witness's past.
My lord, there was no insinuation. I merely tried to convey that a lady of her, what, to use her own words, her unattractive past need hardly have refrained from appealing to her own husband on the score of mainly modesty.
I must ask you, Mr. Keane, not to interrupt counsel. I will intervene if I see reason. Proceed.
Now, I ask you on your oath, Mrs. Paradine. Did you not refrain from complaining about Latour because you were madly in love with him?
Madly in love with him? And yet I went to my husband and asked him to send Latour away? Is that what you think?
Did you not finally succeed in your objective and induce this unfortunate man who worshipped his master to be false to his trust and betray that master?
I deny that.
Now, Mrs. Paradine, is it not the fact that as soon as you discovered Latour took no interest in women, you resolved to overcome that indifference?
No.
Weren't you in love with Latour all the time he lived at Hindley Hall?
No.
Were you not madly in love with him all the time and he lived with you in your house in London?
What you say is not true.
Is anything wrong, Sir Joseph?
My lord, I would like to have an opportunity to consider what bearing this has on the case. I've just been informed that the witness Latour has done away with himself.
André!
That does it. Oh, Tony.
Lord, I submit that this has great bearing on the case. It's perfectly obvious why the witness has committed suicide. It bears out my...
I don't think so. You'll recall that the witness himself said something about not being able to live with the knowledge of having betrayed his beloved master.
I suggest that both counsel recover their equanimity and remember where they are. The jury will disregard the statements of both Sir Joseph and Mr. Keane and all that they have just heard. None of that was evidence. Mr. Keane, do you wish to apply for an adjournment so that you may consider your position?
No, my lord. On further consideration, I have no application. I will, however, have my observations to make to the jury in due course.
Yes, yes. Sir Joseph, does this affect the prosecution to the extent of asking for an adjournment?
Oh, no, my lord. I only regret that the court has been subjected to this additional sensationalism.
Then proceed, Sir Joseph.
Mrs. Paradine, you admitted yesterday that you deliberately washed the glass that contained the poison which killed your husband. Why did you wash that glass? Answer my question. Why did you wash that glass?
You must answer the question.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
Counsel has already repeated the question once.
What does it matter now? Andre's dead. The man I love is dead. I thought about it day and night. But I didn't know how. I wanted to do it so that we could be free. So that Andre and I could go away and live together as we should. But Andre wouldn't help me. He and his honor.
I must warn you of the gravity of the statement you are making.
Andre knew I killed the blind man. Andre knew it. I didn't tell him, but he knew it.
I think it quite unnecessary to ask any further questions, my lord.
Is there anything further you wish to ask the witness, Mr. Keane?
Mrs. Paradine.
I have nothing more to say to you, Mr. Keane.
I loved André Latour. And you murdered him. My life is finished. It is you yourself who have finished it.
My only comfort is the hatred and contempt I feel for you.
My lord, members of the jury, I've done my best. This case has already taken its heavy toll in the life of Latour, in its burden on you, indeed on me. I am more than ever conscious of my shortcomings. Everything that I have done seems to have gone against my client. But, members of the jury, you must not confuse my incompetence with any of the issues of this trial. Those are two questions apart. Two questions quite apart. Many things have become obscured in this trial. Many things have become obscured. Well, Lord, I regret that I can go on no longer. I request your lordship's indulgence to let my friend, Mr. Collins, take over the conduct of this case.
Surprising how closely the convolutions of a walnut resemble those of the human brain.
I wish you hadn't refused. I mean, forbidden me to. Of course, you were quite right. To go to the trial today.
Your coughing, my dear, might have distracted me. It was important that I should concentrate on Mr. Keane's performance.
Of course. How I shall pray the verdict will be not guilty.
Must I listen to more of your silly pity? Every scoundrel, man or woman.
I do pity her. Who needs pity more than a woman who's sinned?
You always forget that punishment is part of the scheme, an extremely necessary part of it.
Doesn't life punish us enough, Tommy? Doesn't it? Why should we hurt each other? We've no right to be cruel. If I'm certain of anything, I'm certain of that.
You knocked over a glass.
Oh, so I have.
Give it to me. I've been talking even greater nonsense than usual tonight, Sophie. I'm afraid this trial has got on your nerves. So I suggest you go to bed.
Yes, I will, Tommy. I'm sorry. Oh, that poor woman. Couldn't you do something for her?
How dare you speak to one of His Majesty's judges like that, you silly woman. The jury decides questions of guilt or innocence.
I may be silly, Tommy, but I love you. I've always loved you. And you must have known for years how terrible it is to love a man who... Oh, Tommy, when you were young, you were kind. But you can't sit on that bench and...
As long as I sit on that bench, my dear Sophie, I shall continue to do my duty. And I have performed a duty today. The Paradine woman will be hanged after three clear Sundays.
Thank you.
next time you'll place your confidence with more discretion. I suppose I ought to get out of here. I've kept you up late enough.
Oh, you're more than welcome. But I do wish you would at least telephone Gay. She must be terribly worried. Worried to death.
She's worried for fear I'll come home, you mean? Well, the least I can do for Gay is to spare her the boring job of standing by me.
Now listen to me, my boy. You're not as wise about everything as you may think. And you mustn't despair. If there's one thing I can't abide, it's despairing.
What would you have me do? Hope for a high court judgeship?
Well, not for a while. But all this talk about giving up the bar is just so much poppycock. If I know anything about Gay, there's nothing at all she wants at this moment, but...
Father.
Where is she?
Some breakfast.
Oh, do you mind? Thanks, but matter of fact, I was just leaving.
Tony, you really shouldn't have worried me like this. I waited up till all hours. I should have known you'd be here, Simmy. I was proud of you today. Yes, I was. Darling, it won't be easy. There'll be those that laugh at you, sneer. And I don't think the newspapers will be very kind.
The worst thing of all is what I did to you.
Tony, the most important moment in your life wasn't when you discovered what you was. And it wasn't really even when you had the courage to stand up there before the whole world and confess your own mistakes. The most important moment. Look at me, Tony. The most important moment in your life is now. My husband is the most brilliant man I've ever known. You can throw away your career and become a beachcomber, if that's what you want.
Maybe that's not such a bad idea.
Darling, don't you understand? I want you back on the job just as fast as ever you can. And I hope you're a tough case. Very tough. So that it will take the very best you have. Winning every verdict you're after. Convincing them.
There you go again, darling. With all your fancy ideas about me.
Incidentally, darling, you do need a shave.
Oh,